Evening. Thank you, everybody, for coming out. For all who are still enjoying pizza and beverages, if you want to come for the presentation, we are about to kick off. All right. Well, I'm going to start with some crowd questions here. So probably some easy counts, but how many founders or members of founding team are in the audience? All right, couple. Of the guys, women who raise their hands, how many of you do your own books? None of you. And how many of you, I guess, have, yeah, close enough. So I usually, when I've given talks like this, there's a comment where, I definitely have the least cool job of anyone in this room. That's not a huge stretch. But in general, when I talk to founding teams, everybody's building something a lot cooler. And I'm really charged with being the outsourced CFO, accountant. I hate the word back office, but basically making sure that the books get into good order and that strategic finance and I'd say just general operations can commence while the real builders actually get to do the cool stuff. So first of all, thank you to George and Tricia and Edge and Node for hosting. We're putting together a series here that we really are designing around four founders who can, should be focused on the build. But the reality is, there's a lot of finance and accounting and general operations that, come into play as you're building a project. Today I'm going to give a little bit of a primer of kind of what you need to know to set up your books and some of the pitfalls, especially involved with accounting for digital assets. But as we get in to the series, we're going to be touching on what do you need to know as a founder when it comes to investor relations? Guess what? When you take money at a seed or Series A level, you are going to be having reporting requirements. Sometimes there'll be board requirements. But M. Westerhold, who's a partner at Andreessen Horowitz, oversees the crypto corporate development practice there. We'll be speaking on that. Following month, Rob Massey, who quite literally was the first in the crypto tech space, will be speaking at the end of August. In following sessions, we're going to be getting into what you need to know about crypto audit, crypto accounting systems, the underlying pipes that will actually take your on-chain activity and bring it to QBO, regulatory and treasury management, and really, I think anything that, I want technical people who are really good with product to be doing that, not worrying about this. A little bit about Propeller. Propeller was spun up about 15 years ago, really with the intent of providing VC-backed startups a full stack CFO down to staff accounting solution. So really, like I said, you have a founding team. Focus should be on building, selling, and scaling, not having a perfect instance of QuickBooks. And while it's always good to have a strategic finance CFO around, there really is not 40 hours a week of a CFO's time at the seed stage, at Series A, and sometimes not even at Series B. So we came up with a fractional solution, really focused on CPG and SaaS for our first 10 years. I joined as a part of the SaaS practice and kind of fell into crypto a little bit by accident. 6 months into my tenure at Propeller, we were in a staffing meeting, resourcing meeting. A resource manager came in and said, "We got a new client. They do crypto, Bitcoin, blockchain. Don't really know what they do. Who wants this?" And I was the guy who raised his hand. And that client ended up being Solana Labs. And so it was one of those, I don't know what this does exactly, but it's really cool and really powerful. And that was really my step down the rabbit hole. And working with Solana was, I'd say that the first kind of thing we realized, or one of the first things we realized, that in addition to finance and accounting that we were doing for all of our other VC-backed startups, there was going to be a second layer of crypto finance and crypto accounting. And that's where we really went deep. Anyway, flash forward to today. We're working with over 50 projects. Still have some work to do with Solana. I am not a far cry from their CFO, but we have involvement with them still. I know somebody with an Optimism shirt just popped in, but work closely with Optimism Labs and the foundation, but a bunch of other terrific projects. Here are a bunch that you probably have heard of. We have a bunch of others that you haven't, but really everything from seed, some of these would be considered Series C or even beyond. So, point of today is really, again, I'd say think about this as a bit of a primer of what founding teams need to know or need to be aware of when it comes to finance and accounting as they get stood up. And this isn't just crypto, but kind of we'll start up here and then we are going to dive a little bit down into what it takes to bring on-chain activity to QBO. But I'm sure this is not really anything that's too proprietary or proprietary at all. You have your general ledger, which is really the backbone of your fintech stack. Supporting that, you'll have a different variety of other applications, payroll, expense tracking, a way to facilitate payments, AP, which is bill.com. And then also a crypto subledger technology, which we'll get into that a little bit more on the following slide. But I think what's really also important, amidst all the technology that's really required, there is the absolute need for a professional service support group that is not just folks that, a tax person who, can do your bookkeeping or do your taxes, who's also maybe working with a pet store down the street. You want crypto tax, you want crypto legal, and you want people who know crypto regulatory as you're standing your business up. Within Propeller, we've seen plenty of cases where projects get stood up, they look around, and they just didn't build correctly because because it's cool to build a certain way doesn't mean it's tax efficient or legal. But getting it right early is important. I think getting into a little bit more of, what does it take if your business is based on digital assets, if you're selling NFTs, if you've got some interesting infrastructure, strategy, DeFi, whatever it is, you can't do your on-chain activity and then just try to wing it and try to figure out what the impact to the P&L is. And actually, you can see there's a little logo under Crypto Subledger. And very lucky to actually have Pat, who is CEO of Bitwave here. And Pat, please actually dive in as I'm going to give the highest level version of this, which is, I feel very lucky that this is where I get to live right now. But we really would not be able to do our job without a Bitwave and a Subledger product. But basically what they do is they take any on-chain activity, any transactions that go on any number of blockchains, in transfers between wallets, payments to vendors, payments to employees, all of those activities have to be tracked, they have to be priced, and they have to basically be delivered as journal entries to the P&L. When you think about also expenses, anything going out when it involves a digital asset might actually have multiple taxable impacts, not only to as income tax, but as you if you're spending or your native token as payroll, you are on the hook for the capital gains from zero to whatever the current price of that native token is. So there's a heck of a lot that goes on here. And without the back-end systems, it's absolutely impossible to do the accounting. And we'll get a bit more into the balance sheet in a second. But you know, there's some goofiness with balance sheet reporting. And let me pause there. But Pat, anything else that I might be missing in terms of, you know, did I just simplify your world just so completely?
No, yeah, you did a great job. No, it's the high level is when you're doing any sort of accounting when you are using digital assets, essentially every single transaction is both accountable as well as taxable. That's what makes life really, really tricky within this world, which is if I give Sam 5 ETH for this amazing presentation today, I've just done something I need to account for, which is 5 ETH. So 5 × 1,800 of ETH minus off my balance sheet. And that needs to be booked into like whatever expense account I'm putting it in. But then also I just sold ETH at 18. And if I bought it at 21, or if I bought it at $5 of the sale, the difference between those is how much I owe. So every single transaction picks up both of those things that you have to deal with. One goes to the IRS, one goes to your, you know, your investors and your corporate accountants and stuff like that. And so something that you basically have to be thinking about all day long. And the really hard part tends to be data. I mean, it's hard to get all this data. It's really complex to get all this data. The data can be very flawed, you know, coming from the blockchains, you know, coming from the custodians, all of that. So it's something to think about early and often about how you're going to pull this data together.
And funny kind of origin story of how Pat and I got to know each other, become friends. We had met at some point along the way, everybody does in this industry. But we had been working, I thought my background's investment banking, I geek out in Excel, I think I'm pretty good at it. But yeah, you know, we had some sheets models, we had Excel models for how we were tracking everything we're just mentioning. And a L2 client walked in the door and, you know, they're like, well, can you, you know, track our on-chain activity? And, you know, we knew what we had to do. And we said, yeah. They're like, well, what kind of volume can you handle? Like, oh, we can handle volume. And they're like, well, we expect to be having 5 million transactions in 4 months. I'm like, okay, well, we're going to have to get back.
5 million a day in 4 months. Yeah.
I'm like, however clever I think I am, there's no spreadsheet that I'm going to build that will handle this. So anyway, that's sort of the start of a beautiful friendship here.
And even that was that sort of shows that client, their network recently went through an upgrade and it broke all of the accounting stuff. Like it's one of those things where, you know, it's not like the thing about crypto is that you don't just build this stuff once and it just works forever. It's that every time there's an upgrade, every time there's a spork or a hard fork or whatever it is, everything changes and suddenly you're rebuilding stuff, you're refiguring things out. They went and then it changed into like there's different accrual models for how their fees are working, all this stuff. So it's just never, it's always, there's always a lot of complexity around these pieces.
Yeah. Now and you know, I think again, this is a story I tell, you know, accountants don't generally get into accounting for systems that are that change and rules that are kind of vague. So it takes a special breed of accountant who wants to actually do this kind of stuff. So something that's a little bit of a goofy piece of the accounting for crypto is on the balance sheet, you are digital assets in many cases, in most cases for non-financial purposes, are considered indefinite lived intangible assets, which means that they can only be marked down, they can never be marked up. And so when you look at the balance sheet, your balance sheet is fundamentally broken. And what I mean by that is, you know, balance sheet at its core, it's what's supposed to tell you. It's what you own, your assets, what you owe, your liabilities, and what's been invested in you, your equity. But your assets now are showing the lowest price of your digital assets, in some cases, depending on what your impairment policy is, that it's ever been. So you really have no visibility to look at an entry on a balance sheet to understand what is, not only you don't even know the specific backup to what's owned, but you don't even know what the real value is. You know, on top of that, we tend to consolidate that reporting into a single line item, which makes it even more vague. But I think then, you know, you get into the term treasury, and you ask five crypto finance accounting types what treasury means, you're getting nine different answers. We've got a perspective that treasury really is focused on providing a full picture of liquidity. And again, so, you know, this is the, you know, the other, what is missing. So yeah, no fair market value. You're reporting at book value. You've got no idea what's in there. And I think to Pat's point before, you can be sitting on, and I've got an example I'll show you in a second, but I've got clients that have billions of dollars of treasury at fair market value that are sitting on literally $0 entries at book value because they spun up those tokens as their native token. There's a market out there somewhere for it, but if they have not been circulated, they're on their books at a zero cost basis. So, you know, I think ultimately when you think treasury, if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. And this is basically how we address this. This is what we call the statement of digital assets. And follow along for a second. But what we do is we take that entry that is on the balance sheet. We bring that to a essentially a fourth financial statement. And then through a wallet asset pair, we show that build. So you can actually, first of all, understand what is the underlying the rationale behind that. But, you know, I think that's just really the start. Then you say, okay, well, what is the actual fair market value for that? So we bring that to fair market value, typically at the pricing at the end of the period that we're reporting on, just to get a sense of the range. And you can see here, this illustrates the real difference of, you know, you have a native token that is on the balance sheet at zero, but can be, you know, in the billions. This is hundreds of millions, but that variance is not unique. That's something we see amongst our clients every time we do a monthly close. But I think going even a step further, and, you know, this is where, you know, you want to, you know, understand sort of what is behind all of this. This is a, you know, kind of a very vanilla wallet infrastructure. We've got clients with 100 wallets that have, it's a mess. But at the same time, there are ways to begin to think about how do you begin to organize your wallets? How do you think about your treasury? And ultimately, we now, when we go through this exercise, we assign roles to different wallets for that have distinct purposes. And ultimately, that can be rolled up in some very usable dashboards. But I think, you know, this begins to answer, okay, well, if you're getting revenue in crypto, you want to be probably turning that into a stable coin pretty quick for tax planning purposes. You could have some yield strategies. There are you know, if you're sitting on your native token, you're not just looking at the value of that token. You know, you can't go and just try to sell that in the market. There is going to be a liquidity discount. But I think that really what this provides, I think where, you know, some of the ultimate value of what we presented, you know, we deliver our results in GAAP. GAAP is largely the language of U.S. business. And there is a big divide when people think about, you know, what is in their, wallets, whether they're custodied or held personally, but I think that being able to think about the entirety of this through a GAAP lens is utterly essential. It's essential for judging the performance of a business, but then also I think as you begin to think about other participants you need to be communicating to, whether those are VCs, whether that is getting ready for any kind of regulatory approval, but really bridging that bridge. So finally, I'm going to pivot over to tax for a second. And this is a day seminar in and of itself. And as mentioned, we are going to actually have one of the, I'd say, most respected crypto tax folks coming to give a talk in August that would be highly recommend try to make. But, you know, going to give some just broad strokes of tax considerations for crypto-based startups. And this is so 10,000 foot. I'm not a tax professional, and this is not tax advice. But, you know, a few things. Number one, taxes are due in US are due in the US dollar equivalent when earnings are earned. If you are mining and you get rewards, it's not when you sell your Bitcoin. It's when those rewards are granted. If you are selling NFTs and you're paid in ETH, it is at that you owe tax based on the US dollar value of ETH when that transaction happened. There was a cautionary tale I mentioned earlier of an NFT project that they sold out in Q4 of 21 when ETH was approaching $4,000. They came to us Q3 of the following year saying they did so well. They had $7 million in revenue at the time, but ETH has gone down. So, you know, they're not going to, you know, have to pay as much taxes. That's not the truth. Pat talked a little bit before about, you know, being very cognizant that a single transaction can have multiple taxable moments. And finally, also thinking about, you know, payroll tax, or if you're going to be using your either native token or any kind of digital asset as a means to pay employees as a part of salary, you are on the hook for the equivalent payroll tax in US dollars. IRS doesn't take crypto for now. Is that a thing?
No, it's definitely not.
I'm like,
it's absolutely not a thing.
Please see. Yeah. I think there are some countries that have sort of broached the idea of accepting crypto as tax payments. Yeah. But I think the big takeaway here is, you know, get a good crypto CPA to help your business out and personal stuff out as well. But all of this stuff tends to move. I think there's always sort of, you know, this looming overhaul, both from a GAAP and from a tax perspective. But all of this stuff is, I don't want to say fluid, but yeah, check with your CPA. You know, finally, you know, I think why go through all of this? You know, I think from a GAAP perspective, you want to know operationally, how is the business running? How did you do last month compared to your budget, compared to your prior prior periods? Number two, how much tax do you owe? Again, I hate that to be the wet blanket and bring tax in at every slide. But, you know, ultimately, I think that is the most important thing that you should be thinking about. And, you know, finally, you know, being very cognizant of runway and how many months of cash you have on hand, and not being also confused that, you know, just because you've got $3 billion of your native token, that doesn't mean you've got $3 billion of dry powder that you can be working off of. And, you know, again, I think, you know, treasury, which is really what exists on the balance sheet in your digital assets amongst all of your wallets, is about having a full liquidity picture. It's not about going for yield, or it could be a little bit, but it's really understanding, you know, what is the state of your digital asset portfolio and being able to plan around that. And then, yeah, that is... what I have, happy to answer some questions. We can talk about what I presented. Also happy to, you know, try to tackle any accounting, finance question as well.
Hello? Testing. Yeah, a few questions about Treasury. I'm not sure if this is out of your ballpark. The first question is, when I'm looking at blockchain projects, it's very difficult to find what the treasuries are. They're not available sometimes. Sometimes they're up in Messari, but a lot of times they're not. And the second question is, when I do find the treasury, it doesn't make sense the way to manage the treasury. Because like if you look at regional banks like Silicon Valley, how about that, SVB, we saw what happened with the asset liability management. They basically went bust because of faulty asset liability management. And what I noticed with the blockchain treasuries that I see, like for layer ones like Solana, what I see is that they put all of their money in the tokens of their dApps or in their own token, and they have no asset liability management, no hedging, and they have very few US dollars. So they're pro-cyclical. So when the crypto market declines, they have no firepower to like fund themselves. It makes absolutely no sense to me. Any commentary on that?
Yeah, and I'm not talking about any client that we're working with. So just to put that out there as a disclaimer. No, I think that there is a community, you know, paranoia or a paranoia of community backlash that if you are not exclusively in your own native token, or if you go into USDC, that you're some way showing that you're not, you know, in, you know, you don't believe in your own token. And I think that this is a masterclass unto itself. And, you know, I think that there's a very, you know, I think there's a lot of different angles to it too, because I think especially when you go to a foundation model, and all of a sudden, treasury is not just, you know, treasury means a bunch of things, you know, once you get out of just a kind of a for-profit U.S. business. You know, that treasury has got to be there to, you know, be able to be liquidated to fund OPEX. It needs to be there to fund projects in the community. And I think that, you know, this is complex stuff. And, you know, I don't know. Some of this is I think there's a community clamoring for full disclosure on this, but there's also, you know, should be some deeper thought for a strategic approach. So I don't know if I'm answering your question, but I do think that yeah, anyway, sorry. Did I come close?
One last question. The treasuries, are they like, there's a name for it, I can't remember now. Fenced off, like let's say a project, we won't name the project, has all of their money and their native token. How accessible is that token? Is it what do you call it, fenced off into another entity where it won't be accessible to them?
Good question. So yes, and but I'd say even within a project, there are restricted and unrestricted wallets. Again, this is very project dependent, but there are tokens that are allocated for specific uses. And that's when you go back to the statement of digital assets we looked at just before, really what that showed is how a project, it's not just keeping, you know, three bank accounts, and then somewhere there's allocations of, you know, knowing where what money needs to go where. You know, within a wallet hierarchy, you can have a wallet asset pair that is restricted, that could be in a Gnosis wallet, that can be dedicated to a particular part of the OPEX spend, whether that's R&D, marketing, partnership development, or, you know, in a lot of cases we see treasury reserved either for grant giving for the community, and I mean, in some cases, a lot of cases for employee compensation plans. So yes, all of those can be separate cases. You can also have parts of the foundation actually be the point of distribution, and that can be done for different tax purposes as well. Anything else? All right. Well, I appreciate everybody coming. I know that I don't know what's harder, talking after wine and pizza or right after lunch. But no, appreciate everybody coming out, and happy to talk on the subject at any point. My QR, I think that's to my LinkedIn, is above. So feel free to ping me, and thank you for coming, and have a great day.